Hello and welcome to our Sunday service once again. It is good to have you with us. Maybe this is your first time, in which case you're very welcome. I hope you're going to enjoy our service together. Maybe you've been with us a number of times in the past. Well, all I can say is welcome back. If you've been with us before, you will know that we're going through the book of Joshua at the moment. Last week we looked at what is probably the best known story in the book, Joshua and the Battle of Jericho. Well, today we're moving into another battle, the Battle of Ai, but this one's got problems, as we'll see a little bit later. But before we do anything else, we're going to share a song together, and our opening hymn today is Before the Throne of God Above. Let's enjoy it together.
Before the throne of God above, I have a strong and perfect plea. A great high priest whose name is love, whoever lives and pleads for me. My name is graven on his hands, my name is written on his heart. I know that while in heaven he stands, no tongue can bid me thence depart. No tongue can bid me thence depart. When Satan tempts me to despair and tells me of the guilt within, upward I look and see him there, who made an end to all my sin. Because the sinless Savior died, my sinful soul is counted free. For God the just is satisfied to look on him and pardon me. To look on him and pardon me. Spotless righteousness, the great unchangeable I am, the King of glory and of grace. One with himself I cannot die, my soul is purchased by his blood. My life is hid with Christ on high, with Christ my Savior and my God. With Christ my Savior and my God.
Shall we speak to God in prayer together? Father, we thank you as we come into your presence this morning, that we do indeed have one who we can call our great high priest, whose name is love. Thank you, Lord, this morning for the Lord Jesus Christ. Thank you for all that he has done for us. But thank you that not only did he die upon the cross, but today he is there in heaven itself, interceding for us. And Father, we thank you that we can come to you this morning through him. Lord, we pray as we share this time together that you would just move amongst us wherever we may be in our homes, that we may know your presence there beside us. And we pray, our God, that through your Holy Spirit, that you would open your word, the Bible, to us today and just challenge us, encourage us, bless us, lift us up. Lord, you know what we need just where we are. Draw near to us this morning, we pray, And may we have that very special blessing as we share this time together. We thank you, Lord, for the opportunity of opening your word and just sharing it online. And we pray that you would indeed bless each and every one of us. We commit this time to you now, Father, and ask your blessing in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Now, in a moment, we're going to have another hymn. It's the good old hymn, To God Be the Glory, sung this time by Stuart Townend. But before we do that, we've got a short video clip of a young man called Zach Whitehouse. Now, Zach has been working with us in Castleton for the past year, and he's continuing with us next year. And this is a recording of him having a chat with Phil Davis online through Zoom, and telling us a little bit about himself. So over to you, Zach.
Not very summery, Zach. What have you got over your legs?
A blanket.
You got a blanket, yeah. It's cold day. Just going to introduce a little bit of what Zach is hoping to do over this next year. So, Zach, tell us, what is TEAM? You're going to do this TEAM program. What is it?
So it's an internship. Or unpaid internship, that stands for Training in Evangelism and Mission. So I'll be working with some counties evangelists and just helping out wherever I can in their churches.
And what drew you to decide to do this year out, or this year with TEAM?
I think it was probably not so much a calling, but a lack of calling anywhere else, I like to think of it as. I don't really feel drawn to do anything else right now anyway, to do with my qualification from college or anything, but I just feel drawn towards helping out in wherever I can in different churches and different ministries right now.
Tell us a little bit about what you'll be doing, or some of the things that you know that you may be doing this year.
So I'm heading off to Tilsley on the 14th of September to spend a month there, just doing some of the stuff that they're doing, sitting in lectures and that. And then coming back, doing whatever we're able to do, helping out in Dunvant and in Mumbles in Castleton, and maybe hopefully being with some other evangelists as well somewhere next year.
One of the things that Zach won't say, but I'll say for him, is that Dunwood will support him somewhere along this program financially, but also we'll be looking for other individuals just to encourage him and support him from time to time financially as well. But what is one of the things that we can be praying for you right now? Because I believe you start, is it the second week of September, second, third week of September? How can we pray for you?
I think probably just next year, like the end of, or summer next year, when I finish team, because then it's, you know, Tom and Lizzie have a time where they were unsure as well. So just what to do when I finish this year, really, where to go.
Fantastic. I think we also could pray for Zach as he works alongside myself and Tom as well, that he'll survive as well. Yeah, that's brilliant. Let me just pray. Father, thank you for just being able to draw as you've drawn him gently, Lord, into this role. Lord, we just pray that you will continue to enrich his life and other people and other young people's lives and children's lives through his service to you during this period and this time, in Jesus' name. Amen. Brilliant, Zach. Thanks very much indeed.
Life and the tone, and for sin, and open the light.
with Ai, Joshua 7 and 8. God had given the Israelites instructions about the treasures they found in Jericho. The gold, silver, brass, and iron. Everything was to go into the treasury of the Lord. It all belonged to Him. No one was to take anything for himself. Everyone obeyed. Everyone except a man named Achan. He took a beautiful coat and some silver and gold for himself. He hid them in a hole in the ground under his tent where no one would see them. But God saw Achan's sin and was angry with him. There would be serious consequences for Israel and for Achan's family. In preparation for Israel's next attack, Joshua sent spies to Ai. The spies returned with a good report. "Don't take the entire army to Ai," the spies reported to Joshua. "It's a small city, and there aren't many people living there. 2,000 or 3,000 men should do the job just fine." About 3,000 soldiers marched to Ai. They expected to win the battle. Instead, 36 Israelites died as the army of Ai chased the Israelites away. When the people of Israel heard what had happened, they were alarmed. How could this happen? God had just helped them defeat Jericho, a very strong city. How could they have lost to little Ai? To show his sadness, Joshua tore his clothes and put dust on his head. He bowed before the ark of the Lord until evening. Joshua questioned God. "O Lord God, why did you bring us across the Jordan River if you were going to let us be destroyed? What can I say now that Israel has been chased by its enemies? When our enemies hear about this, they'll surround us and kill us. Then what will become of your great name?" God said to Joshua, "Get up. Why are you on your face? Israel has sinned. They have disobeyed my command. Someone has taken treasures from Jericho and hid them among his things. That is why Israel cannot stand before their enemies. I refuse to help Israel until they have destroyed the treasures I told them not to take." God told Joshua to separate the Israelites by tribe, family, household, and person. God promised to show Joshua who had sinned. He further commanded that the person responsible be burned to death along with everything he owned. Early the next morning, Joshua organized the Israelites by tribe. God pointed out the tribe of Judah. From Judah, God selected the Zerahites and then the Zabdi family. Joshua went to every person in Zabdi's family until God showed him Achan. Joshua spoke to Achan, "Let God have the glory and tell me what you have done." Achan confessed, "I have sinned against the Lord God. When I was in Jericho, I found a beautiful coat, 200 shekels of silver, and a bar of gold. When I saw them, I wanted them. I stole them and buried them under my tent." Joshua sent messengers to Achan's tent, and they found the stolen treasures hidden there. The messengers brought the treasures to Joshua, who laid them out before God. Now Joshua had to obey God's command. He took Achan, the coat, the silver, the gold, his sons and daughters, his animals, even his tent, and everything else he owned, and brought them to a place called the Valley of Achor. "Why did you do this?" Joshua asked. "Why have you brought trouble on us? Now God will bring trouble on you." The Israelites stoned Achan and his family. Then they set fire to everything and put a large pile of stones over whatever was left. God was no longer angry with the people of Israel. He told Joshua to fight against Ai. God promised that he would give Israel victory. He told Joshua to kill Ai's king and its people. But this time God said the Israelites could take treasures from the city. Joshua divided his army so he could ambush the city of Ai. After nightfall, Joshua sent 30,000 men to sneak behind the city. The rest stayed with Joshua. In the morning, the men with Joshua attacked the city and then pretended to run away. Ai's army chased after them and left their city unprotected. When Joshua gave the signal, the men hiding behind the city ran inside and set it on fire. The men of Ai looked back and saw their city inflamed, but there was nothing they could do. Joshua's fleeing army turned on them and attacked them. God gave Israel a great victory. The Israelites had learned to respect God and to take his commands seriously. God will not ask us to fight armies like he asked the Israelites to do. That is not part of his plan for us today. But he does want us to respect him and obey his commands. When we do, we show our love for God.
unforgiven because you were forsaken. I'm accepted, you were condemned, and I'm alive and well. Your spirit is within me because you died and rose again. I'm forgiven because you were forsaken. I'm accepted, you were condemned. I'm alive and well. Your spirit is within me because you died and rose again.
Ten Commandments. We've all heard of them. We all like to think that we can keep them. But I wonder how many of them do you know? How many could you recite? When I go into schools and take Bible Explorer or Bible lessons, as part of the lesson, we sometimes come to the Ten Commandments, and I usually challenge the class to name as many of them as they can. The usual score for a class is around five. A good class may score 7 or maybe even 8, but I've never had a class that can name all 10. Of course, the ones that we usually remember are the ones we feel comfortable with, the ones we haven't committed. Do not kill, do not steal. We often minimize the ones that we don't feel so comfortable with, such as do not bear false witness or don't tell lies. And one that's often forgotten is the very last one, do not covet. Don't envy the things that others have. It's one we often forget, but sadly, in our consumer society today, it's the one of which we are often most guilty. Last week in our service, Sam Young took us through the Battle of Jericho. And he finished his message on a note of triumph with the words, "With God, the walls come down." And as the Israelites stood there in the ruins of Jericho, triumphant in their first battle of the land, they must have thought, what can go wrong now? The land is ours. We can't lose. But as we turn the page to chapter 7, it's almost like turning off a light switch in the middle of the night, when a light-filled room suddenly goes pitch dark. Israel were going to move from the light of triumph into the darkness of dismal defeat, and all because of one man. And this one man's problem was covetousness. He saw, he wanted, he took. The man's name was Achan, and his failure was greed. A failure that was going to cause one of the greatest and most humiliating defeats that Israel saw. But what exactly was the problem? Well, if we go back to chapter 6, verses 18 and 19, as the city of Jericho fell, Joshua warned them to keep away from what he called the devoted things. You see, on this first battle, God was going to give them a victory without them doing anything. He was going to be in complete control and was going to give them the city of Jericho as a gift so that they would learn that God was with them. But there was a condition to God's gift of the city. All the plunder from that city was to belong to God. It was devoted to God, and the gold and the silver was to be brought into the treasury. So Joshua warned the people not to touch it. Not to take anything for themselves, but to keep it for God. But Achan saw some gold and silver and a beautiful coat. He saw, he wanted, he took. The next stage of the battle was for the city of Ai. By comparison, this was just a small city compared to Jericho. Joshua again sent out some men on reconnaissance, and when they returned, their attitude was almost one of complacency. Oh, it's only a small city. You don't need to send the whole army. Just send a couple of thousand. The result was a disaster. Israel was beaten, and they ended up afraid and discouraged with the question, "Why?" sounding in their ears. So we come back to our question, what exactly was the problem? Did all the fault lie with one man, Achan? Or was there more to it than that? Let's just look for a moment at the attitudes that we find in this chapter. Firstly, there's no doubt that most of the fault lay with Achan's greed, but that wasn't the whole story. You see, in chapter 6, God had given them a great victory. But now it's almost as if they're taking it for granted and almost believing that the victory had been because of themselves and not because of God. Pride had crept in. And when Joshua heard the report and the suggestions of the scouts, he took them at face value. Well, he should have gone to God and asked for his guidance. You know, we can so often fall into the same trap. When faced with life, we can so easily take the attitude, I've got the answer. I can do it. This was a problem that was going to keep coming back, as we'll see next week. But for now, Israel is faced with defeat, and they must do something about it. Well, Joshua does what he should have done at the very beginning. He goes to God, And in chapter 7, we find him face down on the ground before God. And God tells him, Israel has sinned. They have violated my covenant. And so we come back to the question of Achan and what he did. It's clear that Achan's problem was greed, which prompted him to take and deceitfully hide the stolen objects. But it didn't stop with him. The whole nation was affected, and their relationship with God was lost. The relationship that had previously given them victory, it wasn't there anymore. So, how does this relate to us? After all, this happened several thousand years ago, and we may ask, is it relevant to us today in the 21st century? Well, the answer is yes. It's relevant because God's standards do not change. Sadly, neither do the attitudes of people. All it took to break the relationship that God had with his people was the greed and the selfishness of one man. You know, if we are going to live in a covenant relationship with God, it must be by his rules and in his way. But as we've said on many times in the past, the way to God is barred by our failure to keep to the standard that he has laid down. None of us can do it. We all fail. And as we come to the Ten Commandments, we may think, I'm okay with that one, that one, that one, but there are some that we fail on. And we all fail in different ways. Just as Israel were to learn that a walk of victory with God also had to be a walk of obedience, so too, if we are going to walk with God and know his blessings, it has to be with lives that are right before him. However, we are imperfect creatures. And right from the earliest age, our tendency is to do that which is wrong. The smallest child soon learns how to misbehave. And left to themselves, a child will develop a nature which is disobedient and rebellious. Those who are parents have learned by experience how difficult it is to mold a child to live a life that is good and responsible. But this doesn't take away the fact that by nature we all tend to get it wrong. So where does this bring us? Let's go back for a moment to the illustration of parents and children. When a child is wrong, what does the parent do? Well, a less responsible parent may smile and shake their heads and make some excuse such as, oh, he's very highly strung, or she's got a mind of her own. But responsible parents will take action and teach the child through discipline. If they do wrong, then their actions have consequences. For a child to learn and mature, the child has to learn that they are accountable for their actions. The same is true for us as adults. We are accountable for our actions before a holy God. And because God is holy, he has to deal with our wrongdoing, our sin, as the Bible calls it. And he has declared that the punishment for what we are means that we will be forever separated from him. The good news is that although God is a holy God, he is also a loving and gracious God. Just as a parent will look at a misbehaving child and know that that child must be punished so that they will come to where the parent wants them to be, so it's God's wish and longing that every single one of us would be in the right place in our relationship with him. But how can we get to that place? Well, God has provided a way through the Lord Jesus Christ. The Lord Jesus died upon the cross to bear our sins. By shedding his blood, he provided the ransom, the price for what we've done wrong. And he invites us to trust him, to receive him, and to become his. I'd like you to watch this short clip. It's one of the Thought for the Day series that Dunvant Christian Fellowship have put up each day through lockdown. And this one, which was aired last Tuesday, is by Johnny Hardman. Let's just watch it together.
Good morning. For this morning, for the day, I'd like you just to start by using your imagination and to picture this scenario, which I've made up. I want you to imagine a scene. There's this huge ship that's on the water, and something goes awfully wrong, and the ship very quickly begins to sink. Everyone on board, good swimmers, bad swimmers, crew and passengers alike, are flung into the water. And worst of all, it's shark-infested waters. I want you to zero in on this one particular person called Dan. Dan is a really good swimmer, and even he is panicking. He's just trying to tread water, just to kind of keep afloat as long as possible, trying to kind of not panic about the situation. Surely lifeboats will come soon. But anyway, if anyone has reason to be confident, it's him. He is a swimmer, and a really good swimmer. He's competed at national level. If anyone has a chance of surviving, it's him. He looks around, he can see people really panicking, some people who are already beginning to get tired, and he just thinks, well, just focus, just keep swimming. If anyone can survive, it's you, Dan. You can do it. It feels like it's been hours, but to be honest, Dan has completely lost track of time. He just keeps on kicking, he keeps on panting. If he can just keep going, surely lifeboats will come soon. And then he hears something. He sees something in the distance, and it's a boat. It's a boat coming closer and closer. He can't believe it. His spirit is filled with joy. Finally, his perseverance, his ability to keep going, is going to save him. And the boat comes closer, and he begins to see people's faces on the boat. And that's when he realizes that the people on the boat, or every single one of them, are all weaker swimmers than he was. He can remember seeing them splashing the water with a terrible technique, beginning to lose heart much quicker than he was. And those are the people on the boat. And then someone on the boat says, quick, quick, my friend, get on the boat. Dan is immediately filled with contempt. Who are you to tell me to get on the boat? I've seen you trying to swim, trying to keep yourself afloat. You were shocking. I'm a much better swimmer than you. He looks around at the faces with differing levels of contempt, and he realises that he's a much better swimmer than all of those people on the boat. And finally he turns and says, you sail on by. I don't need your boat. I'm a much better swimmer than all of you. Thank you very much. And the boat leaves. And Dan? Well, no one comes to rescue Dan. Ridiculous is Dan in the story. He's trying to rely on his own ability to swim when a boat is offered to him. The only way that Dan can survive is by climbing in that boat. The only way we can have life for all eternity and escape the horrors of hell is to climb in the boat that is offered to us, and that is the grace that Jesus Christ offers us through his death on the cross for our sins and his resurrection over sin and death forever. May we be reminded this morning to trust in Jesus and nothing else, for only Jesus can make us right with God and give us life forever. And if you do not know that truth yourself this morning, please, I beg you to get into that boat and to trust in Jesus, that you might receive life and fellowship with Jesus all the days of your eternity.
The story is a bit of a ridiculous one, isn't it? Who in their right minds would refuse to get into a boat if it meant life? Who would dare to think that they could do it themselves and swim to safety, however good a swimmer they are? But Dan, and I think it's a great story, Dan was looking at others and inflating his own pride. And that's exactly what so many people do today. They think they can earn their way to eternal life by living a good life, by being religious, by living by a set of rules or a set standard. Some people, like Dan, think they are better than others and don't need God's forgiveness. But the inescapable fact is we all need God's mercy, and there's only one way to God. Listen to what Jesus says in John chapter 3. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son. You know, in those few words which Jesus spoke, Jesus summed up the enormity of the gift that God gave us when he sent Jesus into the world. But God gave his Son not just to live among us, but to die for us. And through his death on the cross, we can come into that full and eternal relationship with God, a God who is holy. But you know, the second part of the verse goes on that whosoever, and that means every one of us, the worst criminal or the most virtuous man or woman, that whosoever believes in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. That's it. Believe in Jesus. Now, that's not believe about him. That would be like Dan saying, there's a lifeboat. It can save me, but I'm a good swimmer. No, he had to take the action of getting into the boat. It's not just knowing in the head. It's believing in him, trusting him, trusting his sacrifice to be the means of our salvation, of being saved by him. In our story today, Achan made a big mistake and paid for it. And those consequences were severe. I wonder, when found out, if there had been a way out for Achan, a way of escape, a means of forgiveness, would he have taken it? I think he would. I think he would have grabbed it with both hands. Yet today, God has provided this means of escape, a means of salvation, of forgiveness, in the Lord Jesus Christ. But so many neglect the great gift that Jesus is offering. It sounds so simple. But then the boat was a simple option for Dan. But his pride and his prejudice kept him out. Today, as we think of ourselves, the message is simple. Get in the boat.
Could remember no wrongs we have done. Omniscient, all-knowing, he counts not their sum. Thrown into a sea without bottom or shore. Our sins, they are many, his mercy.
Well, that brings us to the end of our service this morning. I do hope you've been blessed. If you have any questions, or if you'd like to talk about anything, or drop us a line, please get in touch. The contact details will appear on the screen after we've finished. And we'd love to hear from you. If you have any comments to make, please let us know. And I hope what has been said this morning might encourage and bless you for the week ahead. Before we finish, shall we just spend a moment committing ourselves to God in prayer? Father, we thank you for that great love that you have shown us. Thank you, Father, that you look upon each one of us and you long for us to have that intimate covenant relationship with you. And thank you, Father, that you have provided a way where we can come to you and appear before you through the Lord Jesus Christ. Lord, as we come to the close of our service, we do pray that your blessing would be upon each and every one. We would just commit one another to your care. Pray that you would be with us and go with us for the days ahead. And as we come to the close of our service, Father, we ask your parting blessing in the name of our Saviour, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Thank you for joining us. Hope to see you again soon. Bye for now.